get Hive. Kassa going onto the Rift, has started with the Doran's Blade, and of course Ziggs will go with the Doran's Ring. And I thought maybe he would have gone for the blade himself, for the auto-attack damage, but hasn't done so quite yet. Gone for biscuits, so we know he's gone down the middle tree.
He has got a lot of AP right now, set at 41 here, so he's pretty much going, I'm just going to hit you with as many bombs as I can throw at you to begin this matchup. So Clear Love not opting for that AD, just going to, you know, utilize that passive early on. And the one thing that AP Ziggs will do just as well is push waves. He's going to be more reliant on his mana. But, you know, for this situation, it's so important to get that level 2. It's the 7th minion of the game will get you level 2. So the first minion off that second wave will get you an early level 2. We'll see how Kassa can kind of combat the push here from Ziggs.
Yeah, so far neither players are actually pressuring these minions too hard, and it's just the auto-attacks and bombs coming out from Clearlove. So they're actually pushing the wave and trying to get that level 2 immediately. So they're going to be a little more defensive in this 1v1. Bit of housekeeping as well, needs to keep track of those summoner spells. Got the Ignite and Flash coming from Kassa. So Flash on Ezreal as well. Typically don't see that many people go for Flash, especially on Ezreal, who already has the Arcane Shift on E, but maybe he's trying to outplay the Ziggs with some of the skill shots, because everything is skill shot based. If you're in the middle of the ultimate as well, you should be able to Arcane Shift into Flash to get out of all the damage.
Yes, and you know, it's not only summoners that we need to keep track of, it's also the masteries. Clearlove has opted for the Thunderlords here as well. So Grasp of the Undying on Kassa for that added sustain. Clearlove is going for that more damage. So if he can get multiple auto attacks off in this rotation, if he can get Kassa onto the Hextech minefield, that Thunderlord should proc fairly quickly.
Yeah, so actually Ezreal into Ziggs isn't too bad, because you can skirt around all of the skill shots, you can Arcane Shift out of it. So if he knew that Clearlove was actually, you know, prepping this into the game, then this is super smart. But okay, so Grass going on to Kassa means that I'll proc on the Q as well. Didn't see that from Huni, he went for Fervor, then went for the All-In. So this type of playstyle, you're trying to stay in combat by hitting the minions and then hit them with the Q.
And you can see these two trading off fairly evenly right now, but the cannon being alive for Kassa is going to now push his wave towards Clearlove ever so slightly, about two minions in it on this push. That means Kassa is just going to be able to just creep Clearlove further back, and try and get Clearlove to get that minion aggro, because the minions are one of the really big things that you have to control very well on this map. If you can get the ranged minions to aggro onto your opponents by them stepping forward and auto-attacking you, it really turns around trade significantly.
Yeah, but it's very hard for that to happen in this matchup when both of them are so long range. Ezreal, if he feels under pressure, will farm at range with the Q, as you saw there. Clearlove has super long range on the bombs. So even when you're going for these auto-attacks, maybe the melee minions will aggro you, but then you just run away.
Yeah, exactly. Melee minions you just don't really care about. The other thing here is you can see it's so difficult for an Ezreal to deal with the counter push that comes from a Ziggs. As soon as it starts pushing in towards him, one Q onto the ranged minions deals enough damage to pretty much equalize the push, and now it's in Clearlove's favor. As Kassa and Clearlove just back and forth on this very, very intensive minion pushing this far early on in this match.
So to start talking about this, the spell usage as well and what they're scaling up, Kassa has only gone for Q and E, hasn't put anything in W at all, which is a little bit curious because I've seen every single Ezreal do that so far and actually put a point in W, because you can actually go over the minions. Right now, Kassa is finding it very difficult to connect the Mystic shots because they stop on minions. Ooh. W does not, and Kassa actually gets bounced into his relic. We'll take a bit of damage from Clearlove as well.
And that's a massive amount of damage there. The key thing to watch in that is not only was he taking damage from the abilities, the spells, but that cannon creep from the wave deals so much damage, it's about comparable to a champion auto attack. So as soon as you introduce that into the mix, Clearlove should be able to favorably trade against Kassa time and time again, and you can see he burns the health potion from it.
Yeah, Clearlove getting a lot of value from getting the CS as well, because it will give him the extra mana. He used all of his mana to go for that combo on Kassa. Now he's able to get a bit of it back. And that is the optimal, basically the optimal way to throw out skill shots. If you can hit the minions and also hit the opposing champion, you win. You control the wave and you kill them.
You don't win yet, Pulse. 100 minions, the kill or the tower, that's how you actually win. But I like it. It's one of those steps towards
it's getting there. The journey, man.
It is. And the journey sometimes is where all of the intense play comes from. We saw Froggen versus Faker just get really late on with the minion pushing. Very micro-intensive little trades. And here's a trade for you between Clearlove and Kassa, but not a lot of minions around, so both of them are fairly confident in just trading back and forth.
Yeah, so far, they're literally just trading. So when they go back to base, I'll be interested to see what they pick up, because so far, we've seen a lot of AD carries go for Hex Drinker into AP. to go for those all-ins. Level 6 hit by both both of the, I want to say mid laners, and I guess it technically is the mid lane, but both of them are now actually going for a trade. Casa going up against these minions, but taking so much damage from both the cannon minion and that stray caster creep, goes for the relic, goes for the all in as well. Clean up, dropping glow, the barrier has been popped. Both ignites go down. Casa tries to cut the vision, incredibly low. Casa doesn't have the mana.
He can't get it.
We'll go for the relic.
And now the mana is in favor of Clearlove. Casa just wasn't quite in range for the auto attack. I love what Clearlove was trying to do there. Uses the ultimate early to push the minions, force Casa away from the health relic, and try and control the map for himself. He had the cannon minion in the wave. It aggroed onto Casa very, very close. And Clearlove, he missed a bouncing bomb. It was point blank, and it kind of just dropped at his feet like just a marble rolling along the floor was not enough. And Clearlove, at this point, all of the summoners have been used on the map. Clearlove recalls for a very cost-efficient item on 1v1. Catalyst the Protector. Not only do you get the tanky stats, not only do you get the extra mana, but on the level up, the regeneration effect that you get, the health, the mana back, is so, so good.
Yeah, now he wins the sustain game up against Casa. Before, we've seen double Catalyst picked up in the Froggen versus the Anivia matchup with Froggen Faker. We saw both of them pick up Catalyst at the same time. That was very important. This time we have AD-AP matchup where the Serrated Dirt comes out. So we'll be looking for more of those trades versus Clearlove and try and chuck it down earlier. Because if you get into a sustained fight, Clearlove's going to win with the Catalyst.
And this game has been pretty close. It's been back and forth on the CS difference since the beginning of the game, as Casa didn't get a lot of damage off at first.
Yeah, he's still following up onto Clearlove. We'll get the relic, but is in range to continue getting hit by these Mystic shots. That is where Casa can reign supreme in this 1v1 matchup. When there's no minions to block those Qs, there's nothing Clearlove can really do apart from wallow away and take damage.
However, at this point, it's the mana you also have to look at. Casa goes behind the minion wave.
Yeah, he doesn't have any mana to really follow up here and also use the Arcane Shift, so he's not going to be going any further on this one. And Clearlove will have to use the ultimate literally just to clear the wave and go back.
And I like it. He's maintaining the CS lead that he has here. 74 CS to 65. He's finally managed to open up quite a large window here, and Casa trying to recall outside of vision. Clearlove doesn't know he's there, but there's too many minions.
Yeah, I like that from Clearlove. Immediately places down the ward, gets vision of Casa, stops the recall. Does that really benefit? Clearlove does want to keep him in lane because he'll have the sustain. Also on his side of the map, we'll have the relic soon.
Not only that, but he has the push. He's forcing Casa to lose minions time and time again by holding him here. 80 CS to 68. This gap is going up every single wave.
And Casa doesn't have anything in his items or anything in his kit to keep his mana up right now. He's really just trying to get the damage down. And when we saw him push Clearlove to the tower, that was his biggest chance really to get something going. Now Clearlove has forced Casa to stay. This is so difficult. And we're starting to approach 100 minions as well. Casa will dive after Clearlove, try and get some extra damage down. He really needs this relic.
Oh!
Knocks him out of range! Goes to Clearlove. Gone into the barrier this time, so we'll have to see how that dynamic shakes out as we get through this one. But getting onto the rift for Kira versus Bjergsen. This is the game out of this set, stress to watch. And already Kira gets the dominance over that bush,
yeah,
and takes a hit at that ward. But Bjergsen was just slow to the punch.
And all that ward now does for Bjergsen is know, oh, Kira's in that bush. Okay, that's exactly where he should be anyway. So the ward for Bjergsen doesn't do too much, and it allows Kira to now get the first auto attacks off onto the minion wave as it pushes in. We talked about runes, masteries, what would be different. There is a difference here between these two players. Kira has got 7 extra armor, whereas Bjergsen is running flat health. He's got an extra 100 health coming out at the start of this matchup, so there is a big difference. You can see the damage Kira putting down onto this first wave of minions already, rushing for that early level too.
Yeah, okay, so grasp coming out there. Did you say both have gone for grasp in this one?
I will double check. Okay. I believe so, yes. They both have the indicator.
All right, so Kira trying to get this down. It's basically at the same HP. Trade comes across, both lands the piercing light, and one more auto from Kira, but take some damage from those caster minions. Bjergsen actually pushing up here as another piercing light trades back. Another double tap. Literally auto for auto, but Bjergsen getting a slight advantage in this 1v1.
And one thing you want to keep in mind is...
Level 2 from Kira. He will jump in. Bjergsen responds as well. Gets a double tap from the passive. Layers it and weaves it between his passive and his spells. And again, kind of comes out even, but Bjergsen still slightly ahead.
Yeah, and at this point, the experience between the two is fairly even right now. You can see Kira will be able to get the push on towards Bjergsen. to begin this one off. Three minions in the wave, so Bjergsen wasn't quite able to answer that, but he has the edit added health, and Kira has to dodge around from Bjergsen.
Yeah, Kira cuts the vision, goes into the bush. Bjergsen responds with some more autos, backs off to the vision once again into that bush. It's taking damage from that cannon minion on the way out. That was actually huge, and that's really what pushed the health advantage in Bjergsen's favor.
We're coming up to the point where health relics are going to be available.
Oh, drops in, gets the barrier down, there comes the exhaust. Which show is required?
And just with that,
YouTuber will do this thing called trading, which will win you the game. So, getting on to this next one on the Howling Abyss, Prey coming in here up against Madlife. As you mentioned, Stress, who was the real carry? We're about to find out in this 1v1. And so far, Madlife just kind of chilling out of base, deciding what he wants to buy.
And Prey is actually respecting this. Prey was ever so slightly behind the curve on that. And doesn't actually punish Madlife for
the
this.
The ultimate mind game is also, like, oh, I didn't realize the game started.
Also, Madlife is running AP here. He is not running full AD or, well, you know, he's going now for that hybrid style where he's going to get AP later but start with the Doran's Blade. We actually used to see this on Canon a lot on Summoner's Rift as well, where you just have such good auto attack trading very early on. So Madlife looking to just get that early push on with the Doran's Blade. That's why we see it. It allows you now to trade very effectively onto the minions, and you kind of just ignore a lot of the actual champion trading fairly early on.
Yeah, so actually going with this setup as well, I expect him to max W over Shuriken because it's very actually difficult to land that, as we saw, will be stopped on minions in the same way that Mystic Shot will be in Ezreal. So actually just going for those autos, following with Electrical Surge will probably be what Madlife is looking for, but Prey manages to get these minions down a little faster than him. Madlife has actually gone for the W first, so is going for what we were just talking about. Ward goes down, cutting the ability for Madlife to put vision.
And look at Madlife actually not looking to rush, but he's taking so much damage from it. Man.
And Prey's gonna hit level 2 first, doesn't get the punish off because Madlife already took so much damage from the initial trade from Prey.
Right, and this was Madlife realizing he'd already lost that push, so he was conceding so much room just holding the empowered Shuriken as he is now, because he knows he's gonna push into turret. The problem is, on this map, the turrets do different amounts of damage. The melee minions will die to 2 turret shots each without an auto attack. The ranged minions will die with 1 plus an auto. If pretty much anything touches those ranged minions, 1 tower shot will kill it.
Yeah, basically, if the melee minions even, which do so little damage, you are not getting those casting minions. It's just not going to happen. Madlife has gone for a point in Thundering Shuriken as his next level. Prey, again, once again, gets the level 3, so we'll have all of his abilities now put a point in Blood Rush as well. Has control over the relic as it spawns at 125. 2 minutes 25,
yes,
rather, and 115 is the respawn on that. So Prey will be trying to camp over that when he continues to push up. Madlife finally gets the auto down with the W follow up, but the only way he's ever going to get the stun is if Prey is out of position for the Thundering Shuriken or is in range for Madlife to go for his E.
Oh, this is going horribly wrong for Madlife. He didn't get any of those melee minions there. He's still not 100% on last hitting under the turret. And normally, a couple of CS here and there, you may think, oh, it's not that much of an issue. But look at how many he's losing. Look at the gap that has already opened up. We're only on the 4th wave, now the 5th joining. 22 CS to 12 at this point. Madlife is falling so far behind on the minion game, but he is starting to get some damage onto Prey, but it doesn't do too much this early on.
Yeah, right now the win condition has shifted for Madlife from keeping the CS even to maybe looking for an all-in at level 6, trying to burst Prey down for the kill.
Ooh, this is dangerous here. Ooh, Madlife has gone past the minions.
Gets the stun down, but he's in range of tower, so he can't really go all-in on Prey. Prey may go back here in preparation for level 6 and just get some items under his belt.
And Madlife right there goes past the range minions, but is far enough that his auto attack doesn't actually drag the aggro onto him. So he got a little bit lucky that Prey kept moving back away, because otherwise Madlife would have taken so much damage from those ranged minions. And right now, Madlife just looking to set up the push, reset the wave, look to recall himself.
Yeah, honestly, I felt like Madlife knew that. I think he was pushing forwards enough that Prey knew he couldn't return damage onto Madlife.
Yeah.
And going for the trade, regardless of minion aggro, wouldn't have mattered for him. Prey, as you can see, any damage on those custom minions means you cannot get it if it's in the tower.
So, so difficult. And yeah, that's one of those things where it's like, in those situations, you just have to be mindful of where the minion aggro is going to come from, because it will deal so much damage. And if if a full wave of three ranged minions starts attacking you, every single attack is going to be the equivalent when the three of them attack as one champion.
Okay, so Prey should be first to level 6 here as he's got a couple extra minions as Madlife has only now come back into the main. Relic has spawned behind Prey, so we've got that to fall back on. Madlife should be coming up a little later as he took that second. And really looking for this level 6 now, that's a major thing that will open up this game. Big minion push coming into Madlife now. Will be very difficult for him to really push back. He doesn't have any AoE unless he can get a range for the E.
Oh, that first minion. Auto-Q would have killed it. Madlife couldn't quite get it in time either. We'll get the second, though. It's so difficult to CS here unless you can get the actual kind of angle on the Q and the autos in the right time. Madlife's doing a better job now. As I say that, he missed one as the minions aggroed onto it. But, you know, you win some, you lose some.
Yeah, okay, so around 10 CS ahead now is Prey. And actually, first level 6 was Madlife. I was wrong on that one. Now Prey gets to level 6. And Madlife may be looking to jump in here with the ultimate. Prey's not currently in kill range, so Madlife will want to try and get some damage down onto him. But it's so difficult with the shurikens, and if you get in range for the auto with Kennen, you're going to take two autos or more from Prey, which are going to hurt way more.
Yeah. Ooh, you can see there's the telegraphing of Prey now has two axes. How will the juggling go for Prey? This is a lot of damage if he gets two autos up onto Madlife. It will focus down the minions for now, though.
Taking so much damage, stand aside as well. I actually feel like Prey could have gone in for an extra auto down to Madlife, but was paying respect, being so near the turret, also with the level 6 of Madlife. But again, he's not in kill range, so definitely Prey could have gone for one more auto, maybe even two, with the attack speed now. Something that not many people know is you can, as Draven, if you have enough attack speed, you have to click Q again to add more axes into your rotation. So you can actually be juggling like 3 or 4, or like many, many axes. Your max attack speed, I think I've seen someone juggle 5. Probably won't reach that.
That's pretty micro-intensive, I'm not gonna lie. Prey can do that.
But this is all about micro-stats.
That is true. That is true, but so much of it is about the minions. You can't just go juggling 5 axes around and run around and not care. But Prey, taking a lot of damage, will trade it back onto Madlife for now. Very tense game so far, but you can see Prey has extended. Look at the lead he's got, Pulse. 56 CS to 45 right now. Prey is in full control.
Yeah, in the last two or three trades, we've seen Madlife just get ahead, or rather Prey get ahead of Madlife, just managed to get one more auto down on the retreat, and Madlife is just finding it hard to put down damage and bring Prey into kill range, and because of those double Darrens, Prey is basically up to full health again, and once again you see the grass come out. Madlife, his window is closing rapidly.
We're at a pretty important point here, because if Prey can recall, he has the gold for Hexdrinker. He already has the longsword in his inventory, and Hexdrinker is going to go so far against Madlife. Madlife's building at half AP as well. Whoa, that's not a Hexdrinker. That is not a Hexdrinker at all. That is a BF sword that he picks up on Draven. He wants to win this with a kill right now and make sure he can just take out the minion wave as fast as possible and just go fully ham on Madlife at this point. I'm a little surprised at this.
Yeah, that's interesting. And now Madlife goes back. Does he pick up Seekers?
He's got 1,200. He could complete it, plus then go for added damage if he wants it.
Yeah, is it worth with the opponents at 70 CS, though? Because Seekers on guard kind of crap basically by itself.
Okay.
I'm going to fight fire with fire, bringing Madlife out the needlessly large round as well for more damage.
Great. So one thing about getting damage as opposed to sustain on this map is that if you don't actually get the all-in, it's pointless. So, I mean, one of these players going this build path is not going to lose the game because of it, but makes the game so much harder for themselves right now. If Madlife can somehow get, you know, a full ult channel off onto Prey, if he can get that W stun and then continue to just do damage, it could be okay, but I mean, Madlife's in a tough position. Prey actually just needs to farm this out to win.
So important, just right there, Madlife took the relic at full health while he was down there, so that's being denied for Prey. So if Madlife takes a fight over on Prey's side of the map, he won't have that to fall back on, and we'll be able to just go on this on even playing field.
I love what Prey did right there. He had two marks of the storm, so he actually backs off to try and get Madlife to come into W range. The same's gonna happen again. Look at Madlife trying to come out of Fog of War just to proc the stun and follow up with damage, but Prey, last time efficiently traded the auto back, will ult the wave just to make it push.
He's going
to
recall.
Yeah, he's going for the CS win. He's either going to recall here or just wait for the wave to reset.
Yeah, right now being three waves away from winning the game, he's just going to keep farming it out. There's no real reason to try and kill Madlife.
Madlife, I love it.
The side of the map.
I love it. It's great. So with the ward in the bush on Prey's side, Madlife has full control of the area behind Prey's minions. So Madlife never has to cross it and denies so much of this farm for Prey. He says, if you want to go for a CS win, I'm going to make you fight me for it. And Madlife won't take aggro from this until an auto attack lands. He can just queue out again and again and again. They can even hit Prey, and Madlife will be fine as long as the minions are just attacking his.
Yeah, literally notice this. Madlife is not even hitting the minions. He's letting go of to his side of the map. However, he did just kill one minion, and now it's pushing back into Prey. Yeah. So it has now been broken. The idea was fantastic.
It was great. I love it. He sold Prey out for so long. I mean, Prey, as you said, was only, you know, 3-4 waves away from winning this, and Madlife is trying to game the system here. Stop Prey from getting to 100.
Unfortunately, Prey is getting there very quickly. He still has a biscuit in his inventory.
Madlife, he
has to go for the all-in.
He
comes down, and Madlife, he's just not in range, and the autos are raining in from Prey. Defensibles, but comes out, but the exhaust as well. Gets Prey in range, looking for the last auto. Madlife's gonna run away. But even if he goes back here, Prey is gonna be so strong in advantage in the minions. It may just end before Madlife comes back.
Yeah, Madlife right now is, you know, one more wave as the wave joins. Madlife can join it and try and force an all-in. He has the ignite, but he stayed in base for so long. 5 minions is
less
all it's going to take for Prey to win this game, and Prey knows it. Does he recall and safely close this out, or does he go to rush?
He's going for the minions. In comes the ultimate. One more minion. There it is. And the win goes to Prey.
Prey.
Be Rookie and Alex onto the Rift.
And the difference is ignite against barrier between the two of them. Both of them established the ward control. Both of them want to trade. Ooh, Lex. It was Rookie that runs first. Lex throws up the icon. And at this point, so I want to touch on the rune differences between the two because there are very minor differences here. It's Rookie has 3 extra AD, whereas there is a lot more armor on Lex. Lex is at 32 armor to the 23 here, and Lex has extra attack speed. Mm. So in theory, Lex can send out more spears, deal a little more damage on the rend here, but Rookie is going to have slightly higher base damage on his autos. Kalissa, however, remember, scales are 0.9 of AD anyway, so you're already conceding a little of that.
Yeah, attack speed is usually a little more valuable already going for these auto attacks. A slight advantage to Lex, but the all-in comes in from Rookie. It's going to be the level 1 coming in here. One more auto, the barrier comes up, and it goes over to Lex!
Lex gets it! That right there is another example of a mirror matchup where the runes decide so much of this. Also, Lex holding his nerve.
Yeah.
Held the barrier for so long. You can see between these two, good spirits between the two of them. Let's take it up. This one ended so quick. Early exhaust was the problem here. Lex was so high health that he had so much time to hold his barrier. Pops the ignite down. Exhaust.
Premier 1v1 tournament. But welcome to the Abyss. Bush control in favor of Uzi. He's already come face to face. No ward down.
He didn't plant the ward.
Mistake.
That's the key thing there is you have to have the ward to secure control. Kissing has targeted Uzi. No surprises there on the Kindred passive. So at this point, Kissing's actually established the position on the map. So a reminder. 7 minions is the name of the game to hit level 2. That is the first minion off the second wave grants you that initial level up. And that is why Kissing is positioned so heavily forward, because if you can get the initial damage down and get, you know, your wave killed faster, you manage to get that level 2.
And then get yourselves comfortable. Unless Kissing wants to commit to an extended fight, we're going to be looking for the CS goal. So initial push seems to be in favor of Kissing, right? And you can use that Lifeslinger passive very, very effectively. But look, Uzi's starting to peel backwards.
Yeah, you see the ability for Kissing to just sustain up, not only grasp at the Undying, but once he gets more abilities available, Uzi's taking a lot of damage. Heavy trade.
Yeah, so sure. Ignites down. Exhaust is out. Kissing is looking for it.
He got
one
it.
More hit. Kissing takes down Uzi.
He's done it again! He can't believe it again, but he's done it again! And that is just the strength of Kindred.
Reckless
is like, what? How did you win that? Reckless is like, I couldn't do that. How did you do that?
Kissing for picking up the win. Kissing, my friend, catch the Poro. Yes!
He gets his prize. There's the replay. Just the damage from Wolf coming out. Earlier, it's not quite as much as Bjergsen had. He doesn't Doublelift doesn't quite have 100. It looks like he's maybe gone for some kind of like scaling health. He's got slightly less attack speed and slightly less armor as well. So early on, his abilities are going to hit slightly less frequently, but hurt a little more.
Wow, they're going all in already. Grasperdine dying is up, as are the emblems. Serious faces, there's no chuckles. Look at those player cams. These boys are here to win.
They are, but Doublelift is, you know, just having the higher max health is coming out on advantage this early on in the game. And he's got the position. Again, talking about that bush control, it's all about getting the initial push. We just saw it undo Uzi in the last game, and now Doublelift gets the first couple of autos off onto the minion wave.
And of course, both running exhaust and ignite, so the timing on that exhaust is going to be massive. Reckless gets the piercing light and light slinger on Doublelift, but still down in effective HP.
Yeah, and you could see what Doublelift was doing there, trying to trade out of the fog of war. That's the difference between Reckless not having his ward there.
Reckless is looking at those minions, Doublelift is looking at Reckless. I think with a couple extra autos though, it's relatively even, but Reckless still down in HP, and he'll be behind when it gets to level 2. So you can see Reckless immediately peeling backwards.
Yeah.
Arms length, back foot.
Well, that's because he had to concede. As soon as Doublelift already had the advantage, there's no point of Reckless pushing up. He knew the ward had disappeared, so he got a little bit more position through the fog of war in that brush on Reckless side. Doublelift is making sure he's letting Reckless know who's going to win this one. But, this one, it's going to go a little bit longer here. We've gone past that level 2. Level 3 is the next one that we may see Doublelift go all in at. He is quite close. That's a lot of damage on Reckless already.
This is looking so bad for
Good
Reckless.
Good trade for Reckless, though.
Not bad at all. Dashes forward, finds the connection with the Q. Still down in CS, but the minion wave is pushing quite heavily towards him. We'll see how effectively he can CS underneath the Howling Abyss Tower, which deals way more damage than Rift Tower.
It does. Nice, the minions push up. You can see nice double tap. Front minions, melee minions, it's 2 tower shots. We'll kill it with 1 auto after. We'll kill it, so you have to auto tower shot auto. We'll get to that as this game continues.
Lost a lot of those.
All Reckless going for it.
Big damage onto Doublelift. Exhaust is down already. Doublelift held onto both. That is a big, big, big advantage. If a further fight were to break out, ignite, the exhaust ignites.
There's a really interesting mechanic in the Lucian 1 versus 1. Ooh, Doublelift gets tagged with a lot of damage here. Lucian is actually one of the only champions that has a fast enough dash to dodge piercing light. I was looking at Zen of the Stoic, who actually designed Lucian on Twitter.
Hold that thought. Reckless gets the autos down. Doublelift is going to force him away. 6 CS advantage will grow, and Reckless is recalling. Look, chin scratch there for Reckless.
He's like, why am I out of mana? Not too sure. A lot of abilities, that's why you're out of mana, Reckless. But you can see he's just trying to hedge his bet. Doesn't wait for all of his mana to refill here as he comes back into the lane. So was pretty much just banking on getting that little bit more health. But keep in mind, he used that exhaust. Doublelift now has that exhaust, has the ignite available.
Oh, big difference as well with that second Doran's. 97 base AD for Doublelift. This is the 89 base AD for Reckless. And Doublelift has got nearly 120 additional hit points. So it's looking grim for EU and Team Ice.
For now. But, you know, this game still is wide open. Doublelift does have the advantage in both CS and now AD and a little bit more health, you can see. As it does just have, remember those runes he had early on.
Well, Reckless is trying to get some pressure back. He's got a lot of minions on his side, but those minions will push towards Doublelift, giving Doublelift even more options to play out. Gonna be difficult to freeze, but again, look at how much tools he can play with, extending that CS lead. And there we go, trying to stall it out. Reckless goes forward, the exhaust has come down. Doublelift wants to start the fight. Arden Blaze is traded, Reckless will die, and Doublelift picks up the kill.
Yeah, you can see where.
We need to take a look. What is the Keystone Mastery that Froggen is running?
We will get it. We will get there when we
AP
see it.
AP NASA. So we're going to keep an eye on the animations and see if we can figure out which one it is. Koro in lane already, anticipating Grasp of the Iron dying. I can't see that being anything different.
Corrupting Potion as well. So when he hits Spirit Fire, it will push the minions pretty quickly. We'll also just taking a moment to enjoy the beats. We'll also, you know, activate that Corrupting Potion. Fair amount of damage. AP Nasus. It is literally all about one ability. Spirit Fire will chunk and hurt quite a lot. There we go. See, look at it push those minions.
I'd like to point out, I'm hearing from our production that Froggen is in fact not running a Keystone Mastery. He's running 6, 12, and 12.
Oh, he is.
So we'll have to break this down. If this works, this might be genius. But it's going to be on the CX, right? Exhaust, Barrier are the two summoner spells. Froggen missed one. And I think that Spirit Fire might help get this next level. Look, Koro's yielding. He can't stay on the Spirit Fire to farm. But the minion is gone. There's the vault. Level 2 is early. Froggen's in trouble. He's got level 2 of his own. Wither comes out, which I guess would be relatively powerful.
It's like, this is really annoying. Please don't use an attack speed and movement speed debuff on me.
Look at this. Koro just continuing to spam out. Got the CS lead. The wave will be pushing towards Froggen, but Spirit Fire spam is going to make life very difficult in keeping the lane where Froggen wants it to be. Gets another Wither down. We need to see how this one's going to play out. Stress, what are you anticipating in terms of the mechanics of this matchup? We know the basics of Wither and Spirit Fire, but I mean, is Froggen going to get any CS yet?
I mean, only when he's got enough mana to land that Spirit Fire. You can see just how much damage, though, after the Wither in the minion line, Koro ends up taking. Took a good amount of damage. The trade was actually good for Froggen, but he is out of charges on that Corrupting Potion and out of mana, so Froggen's going to have to recall fairly soon.
All right, let's see. What is he going to pick up? Go Chalice, go all in, Spirit Fire spam, and just keep pushing this wave.
I don't know, because then you're getting magic resist against a full physical damage champion. Yes, it gives him mana, but no extra real AP.
The Wither is the piece out I don't want to fight, but so we're never going to see him die.
You're never going to, what's he going to do? Get to 99 CS, hope he got Q stacks on every single one of them and try and one-shot Koro as Koro tries to win the game?
Yes.
Okay, I'm looking forward to it. We're like 6-7 minutes away. I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
I mean, I'll concede.
The Nasus.
It's fine.
I too have felt the Nasus Q spam in solo queue.
Like, look at it. Look at how much damage Koro is taking, though, from these early Spirit Fires. Like, in all seriousness, it is difficult to deal with this early on because it just ticks for so long, and it means Koro is getting zoned away from a fair number of creeps. That means Froggen is staying relatively even on CS, only half a wave behind him.
Yeah, let's see, where is it pushing? We'll take a glimpse of this lane in a second. Doran's Ring picked up for Froggen, as well as more Corrupting Potion charges.
It's pushing away from Froggen until he can reset this at least. There was one extra minion in this wave. Get that Q stack! Oh, he didn't have it! Oh, wasting the charges.
So we'll see if he can manage to build it up. 27 to 24, so the pressure still in favor of Koro, and the wave landing on his lap. It's going to allow Koro to pick up a further lead. Froggen. Oh, the taunt! The taunt!
Oh,
bust a move! Froggen says dance. But the bravado's costing him. He's still down in CS. He needs at least one additional wave. First tick of Spirit Fire, that's hitting.
That actually was the first stack that Froggen has got. He hasn't queued a minion until then.
Well, the crowd is absolutely loving the the jams. Loving. Look at the smiles. Froggen. Now, Koro is all business, and Froggen is loving it. He's like one of those stage performers down on the Third Street Promenade.
This is actually like the most troll Froggen's been. He's like, I won my Anivia Mirror. I'm just going to pick Nasus. You're never going to kill me. I'm going to get level 6. I'm going to wither you, and that's it. Good
now,
luck.
Now, that's the thing, right? The mad scientist in Froggen. Wither.
Cue that minion! Oh.
Wither is going to be your built-in sort of let's never fight. If you eventually need to get to your Fury of the Sands, get the HP, get the extended range. So you've got all these tools, and now Froggen is closing the gap. It's down to 3.
Yep.
From 6.
He's maintaining it. You know, the Spirit Fire is pushing through so quickly. So Froggen will be saving his Q for a fair amount of this because he will need it for a little bit extra damage in the trade. So he doesn't want to throw it out willy-nilly. But, you know, he should get a couple of stacks here in that threat. He is starting to ramp up. But it it's not going to hurt too much. It is fairly minimal, the amount of damage it'll actually add. So, you know, I think as long as he's kind of getting cannon creeps every now and again, he should be okay. It's all about just getting the farm, though.
Where does Froggen pull ahead? How does he get the additional 4 CS to overtake Korra? At what point can he zone Korra away?
He's already kind of doing it, because you can see Karl, now he's going to step forward. Froggen is going to just advance on him until Spirit Fire comes back up. Froggen trying to bait out the fact that he could return the damage, but didn't actually choose to in that kind of situation there. So Korra is getting zoned ever so slightly away, but did manage to get an extra CS. One CS extra from that wave means it's now to 4 between the two.
Froggen is still playing a losing race. You need to overtake the lead person if you want to win. And the current strategy is not working. We need to see an adjustment. Now, both of these players are sitting on over 1,200 gold. 1,200 for Koro, about 1,300 for Froggen. Froggen's just...
It's fine though. Like, I actually don't think it's too bad for Froggen right now, especially if Koro recalls now. He actually recalled. That is disrespectful to Froggen right there. Allowing Froggen to get the whole wave of minions and force it into tower. But here comes the Quinn. How fast can she make it back to lane? This is really underwhelmingly slow.
This is very exciting.
This is so much slower than I thought it was going to be. Literally,
he got it.
It's okay, guys. That was actually really underwhelming.
Now, look at the item pickups. Froggen is now going to be unkillable. Glacial Shroud, another Doran's Ring. So, the mana regen's going to be there.
Hang on. He got a Dark Seal. He got... Okay, so he gets 25% extra healing from potions. I love it. I love it, Froggen.
That was the move.
And AP. He gets
Koro,
AP from that.
Koro backed away.
And mana.
And now Froggen is going to get a 2 CS lead.
Man, this is value. The Dark Seal play.
And look how Froggen has pulled the minions, the range creeps to his front melee minions. Gonna stall this lane a little bit. I think you gotta stack there on that Siphonic Strike. Froggen is now in the lead. AP Nasus.
I mean, Quinn actually can't advance here when Froggen has all of his cooldowns up. Froggen has his ultimate too, and has exhaust and barrier. This is legitimately Froggen say, try and outfarm me. And Koro was a whole wave behind. The recall in vision may legitimately have lost Koro this match. If he cannot somehow get Froggen away from the minion wave, which is near impossible with this setup that Froggen has.
Especially when you consider the barrier still available, exhaust still available, the ultimate as well, and Froggen just continuing to apply pressure to Koro.
He just walks away. He just withers him and turns his back. He's like, you can't follow me.
It's a 2 CS game. It is a 2 CS game. It is still very, very close.
Froggen just used a cooldown of Spirit Fire. And won't be able to push this because he wants Koro to push towards him for now so we can then zone.
Well, withers down. Froggen's moving forward.
It comes out.
But it is forcing out. The ultimate's traded. Exhaust for exhaust. Siphonic Strike for Froggen. He still has barrier. Makes his way over to the relic. And with the fight, Froggen's got a 5 CS lead.
Yeah, and that's what it was all about. Froggen knows as long as he doesn't die and can just regenerate this health, he's fine to lose the health but win the CS game. It's all about CS for Froggen right now.
Koro has got no summoner spells and needs to get through the wither and the barrier. He's vaulted forward. The Siphoning Strike is not really that useful.
Ooh,
and the
Froggen.
Heals are great. Froggen's down to 110. And with the minions in front of Koro, he's going to take the lead. We're down to 11 CS for Froggen, 12 CS for Koro, and they will win the game.
Careful, Koro. He actually just full went 1 CS from that wave in order to stop Froggen from recalling. He knows that as long as Froggen stays and can't farm with anything other than Spirit Fire, Koro should be okay. But look at how quickly those minions are dying to the AoE from Froggen.
93 to 94. Koro's going to tie this up, and Froggen's got half of his mana bar. Needs to time this well. Spirit Fire. He gets two. He gets the third.
Koro doesn't have mana. He actually can't force Froggen off. If Froggen knows he's won it, he's nodding his head. All Froggen has to do is kill the
96.
Range creeps. He's going for the Spirit Fire.
The Spirit Fire's down. He's got two. Froggen needs one more. He's
the
going for the
relic.
Health relic.
It didn't kill
the
minion.
Are dying. Koro's on 97. Froggen, he needs the cooldown available. Walks in.
Missile. Oh, he got it.
He's done it. Not dodge, dip, duck, dive, or dodge any of those wrenches, sorry, arrows thrown his way.
I mean, it doesn't begin with D, but exhaust is the key factor in this matchup. We saw against Kalista, exhaust is not such a great ability. I mean, Dimashka's not, however, punishing it. He's gone for the exhaust himself. So the reason exhaust not so great, because Kalista just waits out the enemy exhaust, and as long as she doesn't die in the middle of it, Ren's after. So you don't actually reduce that much damage, because what is lost from the autos is made up by the Ren.
And of course, what we have seen from the Varus Sai that played at IWCA, maxing the E is a little more effective because it's slightly easier to land. Mm. Faster travel time, less predictable because you don't have that wind up from the Q.
Yep.
You can see the first point for Aphromoo has been on the piercing arrow. Ooh. And already, swing and a miss, Dimashka.
Oh, and now Dimashka trades back. He lands the damage early on and is looking to just take out that minion wave and push through. Also, E is able to hit, you know, more minions as when they're not lined up coming into the wave, so that is another factor for the Varus. But this is a big stack of minions. Aphromoo has not got much damage at all onto these minions, and that one's gonna push.
Already lost one. Should be able to pick up the next two. And for Aphromoo, gonna get level two shortly, but it will be Dimashka that's got the lead. Yeah. Both 80 carries. Running grass for the Undying.
However, Dimashka knows he's not going to be able to trade against Aphromoo just yet, so actually rends both minions. Typically, you don't always want to use your cooldowns to begin. Just because at level 2, you want it available to trade.
And take a look at Aphromoo. He's put a point into Blighted Quiver as his level 2 ability, not the Hail of Arrows. So go for the additional on-hit and maybe some of the stacking. The burst will be in favor of Aphromoo if he can get some of those Blighted Quiver hits initially.
Yep.
But obviously, the longer or the more extended the trade, the more favorable it is for Dimashka.
Yeah, very much so. But Dimashka right now is not favorable on the health trade. Experience now leveled up between the two. Aphromoo is level 3. Can he proc these Quiver stacks?
Yes, he does. Dimashka does eat the piercing arrow, ignite and exhaust down. Aphromoo gets first blood and makes it look easy.
And that is one of the reasons